Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to worship at Canopy Roads. We're so glad that you're here with us today. So I want to give you some good news up front. We are opening for live services next Sunday, May 31st. So we're excited about that. We've worked really hard in preparing for this, and our elders were unanimous this weekend that they feel like it's time, and we can do this in a safe way. So we're excited about doing that. So just review a few things with you, and we'll push more information out as the week goes on so that you're ready for this. We'll have one service at 9:30. We'll not have two services live, just the one service at 9:30, and then our internet service will move to 11 o'clock. It will not be at 10 o'clock next week like it is has been for the last several weeks. So we'll have a live service at 9:30, internet service at 11 o'clock. We already have all of our seats socially distanced in the worship center. They're in family sections. So not only are we socially distanced, we're going to be segregated by families. So that's an added level of protection that the CDC did not say that we had to do, but we felt like that was prudent. So when you come in next week, if you come into the worship center or any of our overflow rooms, there'll be pods of seats that anywhere from two seats to six seats. So you can choose a section, a pod, that is appropriate for your size family, and you can sit by family. So that makes it even safer. So if we have a family of one or a family of six or whatever, then you can find a section that fits your family. So in addition to that, we are adding additional protocols as far as cleanliness and sanitizing. So we felt like we've already done that pretty well leading up to this in the past, but we're just going to add some other measures to that and make sure that we are as safe as possible. We will not pass an offering basket from person to person. The CDC does not recommend that, and so we're not doing that. There will be baskets available at the exits for people who want to give an offering. We will not pass out a bulletin. We will have sermon notes and a communication card on the chairs when you come in. So you can drop the communication card in the baskets and the exits as you leave. We'll open up all the exits so that we won't all have to crowd through one door, all through the lobby, so you'll be able to exit in a fashion that maintains social distancing. We will not have children's services or preschool child care or teen services for now. We're waiting on that. So we invite you to worship as a family, like we did when I was growing up. Like when those of you who are my age, you worshiped as families, and I think that's a good thing. One of the positive things about this coronavirus pandemic is that families have had more time together with less things to do except spend time with family. I know you may be pulling your hair out sometimes about that, but that's actually a good thing, is we've learned to get along together and spend time as families. So we'll actually be worshiping as families too. So I hope that you will not let that thought keep you from coming in and experiencing worship as a family. If you don't feel safe, if you feel like you're particularly vulnerable for the coronavirus, then don't feel the pressure to come back. We want you here. We hope that everybody who feels safe will come back and worship, because there's something powerful about being together and worshiping as a corporate body. But if you don't feel comfortable in doing that, don't worry about it. You stay and continue to enjoy worship where you are right now through the internet service. We will invite people to wear masks if they want to. You're not required to wear a mask, but you're welcome to wear a mask because that's something that a lot of people have gotten used to and go into stores and so forth. Not everyone in stores wears masks. It's not required in most places, not required in the state of Florida. The CDC does not require it, but suggests that. So anyway, we are excited about starting next week, and we'll be pushing more information out about that during the week. Also wanted to just mention something that's coming up special on June the 6th. We're going to recognize the class of 2020, our high school seniors, with a special graduate parade on Saturday morning, June the 6th at 10 o'clock. Now, we're going to do that from 10 to 10:30, so not everybody show up at 10 o'clock. We'll be backed up on Bannerman Road. So maybe the first part of the alphabet, A through K, come between 10 and 10:15, and maybe from 10:15 to 10:30, if your last name begins with an L through Z, then come then. But we want all of you to come and congratulate our graduates. They're going to be outside with their cap and gown on. They'll have a little display table set up with memorabilia. They'll be on the sidewalks outside the church. And so you can drive through the parking lot, honk, scream, yell, have balloons on your cars or signs on your cars, congratulations, whatever, however you would like to congratulate our graduates. They'll be there, and this is going to be a fun time to be together. And then at 11 o'clock, the graduates and their families will come into the worship center for a service. So we invite you to be a part of that. Come and recognize and celebrate our graduates. This is Memorial Day weekend. So today I've asked one of our veterans, Ed Rodriguez, come on up, Ed, to come and share a prayer with us. Ed is a veteran of the U.S. Air Force and the Vietnam War. So, Ed, we appreciate your service, brother. I appreciate what you and all of our veterans have done, and remembering today those who did not come back for their families. So please lead us in prayer.
Okay. John 15:13 says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And that's what military people do all the time, anytime. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, on this Memorial Day and every day, we honor and pray for those who have given their lives and sacrificed their lives courageously for the cause of freedom. Father, we I pray, Father, that their sacrifice inspires us to inspires the selfless love of Jesus Christ in our lives, Father. Father, I pray that you will bless the families of our fallen troops, that you will fill their lives and their homes with your strength and peace. Father, for those that are serving right now, Father, I pray most of all that they have a special and intimate relationship with your Son, Jesus Christ, Father. And bless them, protect them, and just bring them home, Father. Father, we ask you now to bless the service, and we just thank you for all our men and women in the service. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Ed.
You're welcome.
God bless you, brother. So last week, we started a series in the book of 1 Peter that is tied to the theme of the book, which we believe is live as people of destiny. The first chapter begins with Peter calling out the people he's writing his book to as the elect exiles, those Christians who need to recognize that they're special because God has chosen them and blessed them with salvation, and we're exiles in the sense that we're really citizens of heaven, not citizens of this world. We're here, and we're going to be different, and sometimes it's going to look like we're a little bit weird because we are following Jesus, but that's a good thing. And last week we talked about how as followers of Jesus, we have the special gift of being able to start over. He's given us new birth to a new life, so we have new life and new hope. We have an amazing inheritance awaiting us in heaven. We have inexpressible joy because we know Jesus, and Jesus knows us, and God loves us. And we also have a faith that sustains us through difficult times. In fact, genuine faith even grows stronger through suffering. And because of all that, we should live differently. And that's what we're going to talk about today in the second half of chapter 1 and beginning with the first few verses of chapter 2. We're going to look at how we should live differently. As followers of Jesus, if we're following Jesus, we're going to be different from people who are not following Jesus. We should be. Our character should be different. Because we're chosen and members of God's family, we should live differently than people who are not in God's family. In fact, that should be a good thing. It should make people want what followers of Jesus have. The joy, the faith, the fresh start, the new hope, the inexpressible, incredible inheritance in heaven. And as people watch those who follow Jesus, it should be a contagious kind of experience. So what I want to talk to you today is how should we live differently as a follower of Jesus? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, as a Christ follower, I am so humbled that you would want me in your family. And I pray that is how all of us who are Christ followers feel. We're just humbled, Lord, that you would love us enough to give your life for us, that you would want us in your family. And I pray for all of those, Lord, who are not yet followers of Jesus. I pray that they too would feel your love, that they would see the sacrifice that you've made for them, that they could see and feel that you have chosen them and you want them in your family. Today, Lord, as we look deeper into what it means to live as a follower of Jesus, I pray that the things we talk about today would be practical, would be things that would be challenging and inspiring at the same time for us to really follow after Jesus with a passion and live differently. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want to talk about four ways to live differently as a follower of Jesus. How do we live as a follower of Jesus? Four ways to do that. So, and as we begin this time, I want to encourage you to make this more interactive. Now, I know most of you grew up in a Baptist church, or maybe many of you grew up in a Catholic church, and there's just not a lot of talking going on during the message. But a few of you grew up in Assembly of God churches or Church of God or Pentecostal kind of experience. So I want you guys to lead today, and I want everybody else to just kind of go Pentecostal, okay? I want you to engage. Here's what I mean by that. I want you, during the message, to interact with the things I'm saying. I mean, you won't be able to say amen and everybody hear you, but you can give a thumbs up. You could get a smiley face or a heart or whatever, that you agree with what's going on. So let's make this interactive. Let's make our internet experience, our live streaming experience, like we were together in a group with other people. And we could be talking during the message and say, well, I don't know about that, or I like that, or man, that's challenging. So you can do that. You can comment. You can write out a comment, or you can react to this. So let's make this interactive. Let's kind of go Pentecostal through our live stream experience. So open your Bible app to the pane that says Bible, or your Canopy Roads app to the pane that says Bible, and they'll already be queued up to 1 Peter 1, verse 13 in the ESV. That's what we're going to be using this morning. So verse 13 begins, therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully, that's the focus, we're going to come back to that, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. When you look at this in the original language, in the Greek that this was written in by Peter, we see that there's actually only one verb in this sentence. Now, our translation has sometimes yielded multiple verbs, but really they're just participles in the Greek that modify and point back to the main verb. The main verb here is the verb form of hope. And it's in the imperative mood, which means it's a command. So Peter is saying, I want you to hope. Set your hope. Fix your hope. This is where I want you to hope. And he says, hope fully. The word there means ultimate, end, as in this is your main hope. So I want you to set the hope for your life. I want you to fix the final hope, the one that you're pointing your life to, on the grace that will be brought to you, the revelation of Jesus Christ. The revelation of Jesus Christ, he's referring to the second coming, or when you meet Jesus. Now, Jesus is coming back in glory, and everybody's going to see him. There's going to be a time when he comes back and everybody sees him. But Jesus is coming for people every day, right? So I may meet Jesus before what the Bible would be looking at toward the second coming. But actually, the words in the Bible do not say second coming. The Bible says the parousia, the coming of Christ, is what we're anticipating. So Christ may come for you today, or next year, or 10 years from now, or he may come for everybody in the next 10 minutes. So the point is that we need to set our hope fully on the return of Christ and And also that we'll focus on the grace that will be brought to us. That is the rewards, the blessings that we'll have after we meet Christ. So here's the live differently element of this. Live with hope for Christ's return. Live with hope for Christ's return. Do you? I mean, did you wake up this morning thinking, man, you know, Jesus could come back today? I confess to you, today's about the first day in a long time that I woke up like that. You know why I woke up that way? Because I'm preaching on it, okay? So sometimes it helps to be preparing for a lesson. But, you know, we should all wake up with the sense that today I could meet Jesus. And we need to think about that and realize that today could be the day that we meet Christ. Are we ready? Are we living with a hope? Or do we wake up and think, man, I hope Jesus doesn't come back today. I got stuff to do. Well, if it's stuff to do for him, that could be okay. But if it's stuff to do that has nothing to do with him, then if we're following Jesus, we should look forward to him coming back. That's just what he's saying here. So maybe we need to think about what we will receive when Jesus comes back. What is the grace that he's talking about? We'll receive grace, and we'll receive rewards from Christ. The judgment that will happen when Christ returns will be for all who are not believers, that is, judging sin, but Christians will be judged for how we've lived our lives. Now, verse 7 in chapter 1 says that those who have genuine faith, the tested authentic faith that's tested even by suffering, will result in three things. He says, praise, glory, and honor when Jesus returns. So think about it this way. How awesome would it be when you meet Jesus to say, I am so proud of, and fill in your name there. I'm so proud of Terry. Man, she is my girl. She is so incredible. She has loved me with a passion. She has shared her faith with her friends. And there are people in heaven today and people that are on the way to heaven because of the courses she's taught and the influence she's had with meeting people for dinner or for coffee. She has been someone who's lived sent. She is someone I am so proud of. That's what we should live for. We should live for the day that we meet Jesus, for the praise, glory, and honor that we'll receive at that time. Not only are we receiving the permanent body that we'll live in forever, that never gets tired or weary, and we're living in a paradise face-to-face with Jesus forever, but we'll receive rewards based on how we've lived or not lived our lives. So, if we really look forward to Jesus coming, we will live in such a way that we want to please Jesus. Let me ask you a question. In all honesty, would you say that you're living your life to please Christ, or you're living your life to please yourself? If we're real honest, most of us would have to say, you know, I'm living my life mostly to please myself. Or some might say, I'm living my life to please my kids. Get that? Living my life to please my spouse, my boss. At the top of the list has to be living your life to please Christ. If you're a Christ follower, you'll anticipate Christ's return. You want to live your life in a way to please him. So how do we do that? He says, preparing your minds for action. What he means there is to think deeply about how you would live your life for Christ. Think deeply about, when you read something in the Scripture, do you think about, how does this apply? We don't just need to understand what the Scripture says and what it means, but how does it apply? What difference should this make in the way that I'm living at work? The way that I'm dealing with my courses and my classmates and my teachers at school? The way that I'm functioning on a team with a coach? The way that I'm treating my siblings or my parents or my kids? the way that I'm treating my friends and the way that I deal with friendships, the way that I deal with broken relationships and strained relationships, the way that I manage my finances. Christianity is a thinking faith. This week we lost one of the great thinkers of our time, Ravi Zacharias. Ravi was a deeply intelligent and thoughtful man. And one of the things I most appreciate about him is how he ties our beliefs to our worldview. The worldview is the way that you view reality. Ravi thought that the way we think about our faith will color, in fact, will drive the way we think about everything else. Our worldview, which should be seen through the lens of God and through the lens of Scripture. So when we think about how we should live our lives, that means when we read the Scripture, we think about how does this apply to my life? He also says a second thing to help us with living with hope and how that works out to please Christ is to be sober-minded. In other words, you could say exercise self-control. That is, not let the world inoculate you with values that are not becoming of Christ. One of the commentaries I read this week said, avoid becoming intoxicated with the attractions of the world. We can become intoxicated with the attractions of the world, right? We can be distracted by attraction of worldly things. We can also be distracted by rejection by worldly people. So we need to exercise self-control. Don't let the attraction of worldly things pull us away from Christ, nor let the opinions of people who are worldly rejecting us, let that pull you away from your commitment to live for Christ. 1 Peter 1, verses 4 to 16. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you shall also be holy in all your conduct. There's the phrase we're going to come back to. Be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. The first thing we need to do to live differently is we need to anticipate the return of Christ. We live with hope for the return of Christ. That is, to live in a way to please him. Secondly, we need to live holy. We should live holy. He says, be holy. That's the main verb here. Everything else in these two verses draws its power from the command. Once again, it's an imperative mood, which means this is a command. Be holy in all your conduct. Being holy is not being religious. Okay? You can be very religious and very ungodly. There's a word for that. What is it? Yep. Hypocrite. Exactly. Hypocrite. We can be very religious and still not be very Christ-like. We can show up in church services. We can be we can volunteer for things. We can give our money and still live like the world when nobody's looking. So it's not religious. Holy is beyond that. Being holy means to be like Jesus. Holy means set apart. In this context, he's talking about being set apart from worldly values, to have godly values, to have godly morals and ethics and character. So being holy like Jesus means to live with his sense of justice, his sense of morality, his sense of ethics, his sense of love and compassion for people. Holy is who we are as Christ followers. We are holy because in the very first couple of verses of the book of 1 Peter, he talks about the fact that we're chosen. So God has chosen, I want you in my family. And when we accept that, when we receive that by faith, then we are set apart. That is, we're God's children. So we are holy. We're already set apart for God's use, for God's glory, for as sacred people. And next week, we'll talk more about that. We'll really drill down on this idea of being a holy people. He talks about that really, the focus of chapter 2 is on that. So we are already holy, so we need to act like who we are, or at least who we claim to be. If we don't act like who we said we are, then maybe we are not Christ followers. So So we should act like Christ if we're following Christ. Notice he says, he kind of adds a modifier to what it means to be holy in case we are unclear about that. He says, be holy in all your conduct. Holiness is expressed through behavior. If you're holy, if you're living holy, it'll change the way or affect the way you behave. You should be able to look at your behavior and discern, I'm holy, I'm not holy. Now, don't hear me saying we're supposed to be perfect, and we should strive for that, but nobody's going to be perfect, and nobody should have this sense of I'm holier than thou, that is arrogance, that's not holiness. It should drive our behavior, though. It should change the way and affect the way and drive the way we behave. Notice also, not only be holy in your conduct, be holy in what part of your conduct? All. Being holy is all-encompassing. Have you noticed that strawberries are cheap right now? It's strawberry season in Florida, and apparently in California too. So strawberries are cheap. I love strawberries. Okay, I hope that Terry's going to make some strawberry jam this week. She bought a bunch yesterday, so my mouth is already starting to water. I love homemade jams and jellies. Strawberry jelly may be my favorite. It's certainly one of my favorites. Anyway, so we pulled a couple of strawberries out that weren't quite ripe and set them in the window, hoping they'd ripen up a little bit. And I was looking at one of them, I don't know, midweek, and I saw this brown spot on there. Strawberries are not supposed to be brown, okay? Red and brown, not the same thing. So I looked on there, I saw that brown. So I picked that strawberry up, and I just plopped it in my mouth to see if it tastes good. No, I didn't do that, okay? You wouldn't do that either, because brown was rotten. And when you started cutting on it, the brownness kind of went all the way in. There's rottenness there. That's unholiness, right? You see, God wants us to live life without rottenness. If there's rottenness in our lives, it's a bad witness to people around us, and we're lying to ourselves. If we're comfortable with rottenness in our lives, it will eventually go down deep and affect all of us, our whole person, our whole character. So we can't be content with a little bit of rottenness and mostly goodness. You don't want partially rotten strawberries. They're terrible. They'll make you sick. See, we make the world sick when we allow a little rottenness to be in what should be a holy character. Because we're here to witness to the world. We're here to attract other people to Jesus. We're here to live out our faith and honor Him. So living holy means living without rottenness. Living holy is living with integrity. Integrity means complete and whole. That is, what's on the inside is what looks like on the outside. So if sometimes you cut into fruit that was rotten on the inside but looked great on the outside. A few years ago, we brought a cantaloupe home and set it on the counter, and you know, we didn't get to it right away. It was 3 or 4 days, and I noticed one day that there were some bubbles coming out of the cantaloupe. I said, Terry, I don't think that's good. there was a bacterial colony that was having a great time just eating that cantaloupe from the inside. It was rotten on the inside. It looked great on the outside when we bought it, but it already had the rottenness on the inside. So integrity means it's the same through and through. So living holy is living with integrity. So how do we live holy? He gives us some pointers here. He says, as obedient children. When God calls us into His family, we're His children. So He's the Father. By obeying God as Father, that's how we learn to live holy, is by obeying what He says. He's not left us in the dark about that. He sent us a very detailed text message that's made up of 66 books from Genesis to Revelation. If we read His text and try to pay attention to what it says and live it out, then we will live holy. So we need to obey Him as Father. He's equipped us also with a moral compass. Even before we're believers, we have a natural sense of right and wrong. Even 3-year-olds and 4-year-olds have a sense of fairness. Well, that's something that God has built into us. And it's a craving that makes us crave God, because He's built into this moral oughtness in all of us. It can be corrupted, but it can also be cultivated. And when we become a believer, God also plants His Holy Spirit in us to be not only an amplifier of our moral compass, that is our conscience, but also an interpreter of His Word, so that we can, when we read it, the Holy Spirit interprets it, our moral compass grabs that because of the power of the Holy Spirit in us, so we get it, we can understand it. So then all we have to do is decide, okay, I'm going to obey it. So as obedient children, and by repenting of former sinful habits, so obeying God as Father and repenting of former sinful habits, He says, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance. That He's writing to people who mostly came from a Gentile background. They weren't Jewish, so they didn't know about the Old Testament. They didn't know about God's laws. Most of these people, Yahweh, Jesus is a brand new thing to them, a brand new idea. So they didn't have a sense of morality having grown up in a Christian culture. It was all new to them, so they had former ignorance of that. So they had lots of bad habits based on that. And so He says, don't fall back into that. Don't let those things draw you back into your former way of life. Bad habits have a huge attractional power, a huge gravitational pull on us. When we have been conditioned to do something that's wrong, then we come to Christ, those bad habits are going to continue to pull on us. So we have to really focus on changing our the way we think about that, repenting, and say, those things are things I need to move away from and move aggressively toward God. So obey God as Father and repent of former sinful habits. So the second thing we should do in order to live differently is to live holy, that is, live with integrity. The third thing we should do is found in verse 17. And if you call on Him as Father, who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile. What? He says, be afraid. I thought the most frequent command in the Bible, maybe you've heard this, is fear not. I did a little research this week. Fear not occurs 70 times in the ESV, English Standard Version. But also, fear God appears 40 times, or 49 times. So almost as many times, He says, fear me as fear not. So what are we supposed to do, fear or fear not? What He's saying here is don't be afraid of everything else. Fear only me. That is, have respect for me. We should fear God as our loving Father. We should fear Him because He is the one who will judge us. And if we fear Him, then we won't have to fear anything else because we're loved by Him. We're in the family. So we should have a holy respect for Him. So we should live reverently. That's what He's saying here. Live reverently. Reverence is a combination of love and fear and respect. I love my dad deeply, and my dad loved me. We had a great relationship. But when Dad said to do something, he meant it. And when I didn't do it, or I intentionally did something differently, there was a consequence for that. And I feared that. I feared my dad's discipline. I feared his judgment. Not being judged, but not measuring up to what he told me to do, because there were consequences for that. And that's what he's saying here. We should fear God. We should fear the fact that He is our Father, and we should fear what He says to do if we don't do it. So we should live reverently because God will judge how you live. God will judge how you live. But if you're a Christ follower, right, he doesn't judge you. Oh, yes, He does. Christ followers will face justice too. You can look these up later. You write these down. Romans 14:12. To every one of us shall give account of himself to God. And 2 Corinthians 5:10, which says, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ to receive what's his reward or punishment really based on what we've done in the body, whether good or bad. So we're all going to have to give account Christians will not be judged for their sin. The sin has already been paid for. Okay, so you can give a big sigh of relief. Okay, I thought you were saying we're going to be judged for the bad stuff we've done. Not exactly. We won't be condemned for that. But we will be judged on how we've invested our lives, how we've used our lives. If we've wasted our lives in sin, instead of investing our lives in service, we're going to be judged for that. So it's important that we understand that we will be judged for that. So we need to live reverently because we'll have to give an account to God for how we've lived our lives. There's another reason as well, beginning in verse 18. Knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. That's a lot there. Let me kind of focus here. So we don't have time to dig out this very deeply, but I just want to focus on the main thing. He says, you are ransomed with the precious blood of Christ. So we should live reverently because Christ redeems you with his blood. Because Christ redeems you with his blood, so you should live reverently because of the price that was paid. So our motivation is not just concern about having to give account for how we've lived, that is, to face the judgment. Our motivation should also be gratitude for what Jesus has done for us. Man, we should live reverently, respecting Jesus and wanting to please him because of what he's done for us. He gave his life for us. So, have you lived reverently this past week? Would you say that you've lived with respect? That you've tried to honor God with your vocabulary, your choice of words? You tried to honor God, live reverently with the way you treat people, with the way you refer to him, whether you use his name with respect or use his name in vain? Have you lived sent? That is, live sent on the mission that Jesus has sent you on. So we need to live reverently. We need to live holy. We need to live with hope for Christ's return. And in verse 22 and 23, we see another way for us to live differently. Having purified your souls by obedience to the truth, for sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly. That's the focus. Love one another earnestly. From a pure heart, since you've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. He says, look, you should love sincerely because of all these things that have been done for you. Now, it's interesting here that he brings in two different kinds of love. The Greek language is much more specific about love than our language. There are three different Greek words for love. Eros, is from which we get the word erotic, means sexual love. But there's also another word, phileo, which means brotherly love, and agapao, or agape, which means the love of God, the love of Christ. In this passage, brotherly love, phileo, as well as agapao are both in here. Brotherly love translates the word Philadelphian. Philadelphia. What's the nickname for Philadelphia? The city of brotherly love. Exactly. Philadelphian. That's the brotherly love is the Greek word Philadelphian. Love one another is the Greek word agapao. Agape love, the love of God. So he says, you have purified your souls by obeying Christ. That is, you followed Christ in faith. So you have brotherly love for each other, and you should have that, but you also should love one another with the love of God. And he even adds a clarifier to that. He says, earnestly or deeply. So how is loving God different than loving like God different than loving like anybody else? Well, I love what Tim Keller says. He said, it is the sincere desire of every person to be fully known and truly loved. For someone to know all about you, all of your quirks, all of your bad habits, all of your history, everything about you, all the baggage and all the good, and still love you. And that's the way God loves us. Another way of saying that is unconditional love. He loves us in spite of our flaws. He loves us in spite of our sin. Flaws and sin are not the same thing. He loves us in spite of our sin. He loves us without regret or resentment. He loves us unconditionally. So what he's saying here, to live differently, we should love deeply. Love deeply. Love with a brotherly love that is common to people who really care about each other. But beyond that, love with the love of God, which is unconditional. How can we ever love like that? That seems like an unattainable goal, even in marriage, even with kids. To love unconditionally, to love no matter what. So he gives a couple of helps, not a complete exegesis of this and not a complete explanation of this, but just some tips. He says, by cleaning out unloving attitudes and behaviors, he begins this in verse 1 of chapter 2, by cleaning out unloving attitudes and behaviors, you can't love someone with the love of God when you have naturally occurring sinful behaviors and attitudes that are unloving. So he gives us a partial list here in 1 Peter 2, verse 1. So put away all malice, all deceit, and hypocrisy, and envy, and all slander. Every single one of these words are anti-loving words, right? Can you love someone that has malice towards you, that has evil intent, that wants you hurt? It's hard. Really hard. If you have that in your heart, you can't love somebody. It's hard enough to love them. You can't love somebody if you have malice in your heart. If you have deceit, that is, you're trying to deceive someone. You're hiding something from someone. To hide something from someone is to not love them. All the other behaviors are you can see are the same way. So identify and then eliminate these behaviors. So call them out. And carry them out. Get rid of them. Cast them out. Call them out. Clean them out of your life. All these. This is just a partial list. Anything that's an unloving attitude or behavior, he says, identify it, call it out, and then cast it out of your life. Get rid of it. He also says, so that's the negative side of what we need to do in order to love like God. There's a positive side, though. By craving spiritual food to grow up in Christ. He says, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you've tasted that the Lord is good. If you're a follower of Jesus, you've tasted and seen God's good. Otherwise, you wouldn't start following Jesus. He loves me. He loves you enough. He loved me enough to give his life on the cross. He wants what's best for me. He's going to help me through difficult times. I've tasted and seen that this is good. So I need to crave to grow in that. Spiritual milk, that's referring to God's word. He's referring back to verses 23 through 25. In fact, we can go back and see that at the end of verse 23. He says, you've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and abiding word of God. So he's looking back to the word of God. That's your spiritual food. God's word is our spiritual food. We need that. Like the prophet Jeremiah said, your words were found and I ate them. So we need to consume God's word. I have two new grandchildren. One is 8 months and one is 6.5 months. Man, they're growing like weeds. And they crave mama's milk. They crave milk. In fact, they crave it so much that you're going to get it until they stop craving. Okay? They're going to keep you awake. They're going to cry in the middle of the night. And they're going to get louder and louder and louder and more worked up until they just get what they want, until they get it. And he says, we need to crave, we need to want God's word just like a baby. Just like the baby that kept you up in the middle of the night. If you've ever had a child, brought one home in the hospital, you know what it's like, man. You can forget sleep, a full night's sleep for several months. We need to crave spiritual milk, that is the word of God, the way they crave mama's milk or formula or whatever. So, what if you don't like spiritual food? I mean, did your mama ever make you eat some stuff you didn't like? Yep. You know the strange thing? I like some of those things today. I actually do. I like things that my dad liked that I didn't like back then. I like liver. I like oysters. I like turnips. I didn't like any of those things. I even like, this is a new thing, I'm like Brussels sprouts. I thought they were gross, okay? But I've started eating them the last 4 or 5 years. Those things are good for you. And I started eating some of those things because the mentors in my life ate them. I wanted to like liver so much because my dad, my uncle, and my grandfather loved liver. And it was like the manly thing to do, to eat liver. And I hated it, but I started eating it. You can start with chicken livers. If you want to learn to like livers, fried chicken livers, that's an easy way to start because it's got a lot of stuff on the outside. But less liver taste. But eventually I got to where I actually like liver and onions, which is like pure liver taste. Because I cultivated a taste. Look, if you don't like reading the Bible, the more you read it, the more you'll begin to like it. A lot of you drink coffee. First time you had coffee, tastes like charcoal, didn't it? Yep, smelled really good, tastes like dirt. Now you like it. Same thing about beer. Tastes like, well, I won't go there, okay? But you, many of you drink it anyway. You know, you cultivate a taste for it. How much more should we cultivate a taste for God's word? Because it's good for us. It helps us grow up, he says, grow up in our salvation as grow up in Christ. Here's the deal. Tie it back to love. The more you grow up in Christ, the more you'll love like Christ. I watched a great movie on Netflix this week. I didn't see it when it came out in the theaters. It's The Case for Christ. It's the true life story of the conversion of Lee Strobel, one of the great Christian authors of our time. He was an atheist. Worked with the Chicago Tribune. He was a Pulitzer Prize winning writer for the paper. And just a brilliant young guy, very anti-God. And I won't get into the whole story, but his wife became a Christian first, and he hated it. He couldn't believe that she was abandoning their atheism, and he was concerned about it corrupting their daughter and corrupting their house. And he even told her, I don't know if I can be married from you 2 years from now if you continue this. And she says, Lee, I love you more now since I became a Christian. The more I grow in Christ, the more I love you. Man, he couldn't receive it at the time. Eventually he did. But that's the lived out expression of what I'm saying here. What Peter's saying is that if you grow up in Christ by consuming spiritual nutrition, you'll grow to love like he does. The more you mature in Christ, the more you will love others like he loves you. So here's our big idea, kind of wrapping all these things together. Christ followers live with hope, live holy, live reverently, and love deeply. That's how we should be different. Live with hope, live holy, live reverently, love deeply. That's contagious. When you're around someone that acts like that, it makes you want to be like that. It makes you admire someone like that. They may be younger, they may be older, they may be the same age. They may be your boss, they may be your employee. They may be your child or your parent. It doesn't matter. Their position doesn't matter. This life, it's compelling. You want some of that. I did. I saw it in my parents. I wanted that. Many of you are believers today because you saw that lifestyle lived out and you wanted that. Maybe you're watching today and you'd honestly say, look, Pastor, I'm not a follower of Jesus. But what you've talked about today is compelling. I want to love deeply. I want to love like that. I want to be loved like that. I want someone to know me fully and love me truly. In fact, I want to be like that too. I want to be able to know people fully and still love them truly. I want to live reverently. I want to live with integrity. I want to live with hope. Do that. The same way that everyone who's watching this today is already doing that because they're a follower of Jesus. When you begin following Jesus and continue following Jesus, this becomes natural because you're living out who you really are. You're holy. You're living out that holiness. You're living out that reverence because you appreciate so much of what he's done for you. You're living with hope because he's placed that hope and planted it in your heart. You love deeply because you've been loved deeply and you know what it feels like. Love others that way. If you would like to live like this, if you want this life, it is only found. a relationship with Him. Place your trust in Him today and tell Him that you want to be one of His followers. Your life will begin to change. Your destiny will be instantly changed. You'll be given a fresh chance, a fresh start in life, and you'll be given the riches of heaven guaranteed for you. But He'll also begin to change the way you live and change the way you feel and change the way you act, the way you treat people, your attitudes, your beliefs. It'll begin a transformation of you. You'll like it. You trust Christ today. If you'd like to trust Christ, you can do that right now, wherever you are. If you're driving, I encourage you just to pull off the side of the road and just stop so you can focus on this. If you're at home with other people, you can just focus right where you are. If you need to go in another room, that's fine too. But just get away where you can focus on this and talk to God and talk to Jesus. If that's what you'd like to do, let me lead you in a prayer. And you tell Jesus what you would like. Something like this: Dear Jesus, I want to be one of your followers. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for choosing me. In spite of my sin, in spite of my flaws, in spite of my history and background, thank you for loving me and choosing me. I trust you. I want to follow you. So come into my life. Make me a follower of Jesus right now, today. Thank you, Jesus, for bringing me into your family. Thank you, Jesus, for the people who are listening and those who have just placed their faith and trust in you. Thank you, Lord, for the promise that he who believes has eternal life. Thank you so much, Lord. We celebrate those new births in your name. Amen. If you receive Christ this morning, please let us know. What I'd like for you to do is give us an emoji. Give us a hands up emoji, or maybe a shouting hands emoji. Give us an emoji to let us know, and we will private message you. We'll follow up with you and help you with some next steps about what to do now that you're a follower of Jesus. Also, if you recommitted your life to Christ today, let us know that. You can send us a thumbs up, and we would love to follow up with you as well. If you have a prayer request, something going on in your life, and you just want somebody to pray for you, there are two things you can do. You can email us at prayforme@canopyroads.org, prayforme@canopyroads.org, or you can just do a praying hands emoji, and we'll private message you. We'll follow up with you, and it'll be just between you and Pastor Justin and myself. We're the ones who look at the stream. So we would love to do that. So you just let us know how we can pray for you today. So if you accepted Christ, give us a hands up. If you recommitted your life, give us a thumbs up. If you need prayer, give us a praying hands, and we'll private message you. We'll follow up with you. So we're going to close our service today with some praise music. So join us as we sing. Confidence drawn near for the one who holds the heavens. And-
tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice when you cry to him, he hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice in the midst of suffering, he will help you sing. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King.
Thanks, guys, for joining us. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you next week.